Hello everyone and welcome to Until the End of Time. Hope you're having a great day. My name is Werner. Today we're going to be looking at a couple of new cards that have been trickling in over the last couple of days. We have a new Daisy Walker, a parallel Daisy Walker, which was the new print and play announcement we've been looking forward to for a bit now. A lot to talk about there. We also have two new previews for the Nathaniel Cho Investigator starter deck. And I think we're just going to start there. So, in case you've forgotten who Nathaniel Cho is, he is the boxer from the Investigator starter deck. He's the Guardian. 3 willpower, 2 intellect, 5 combat, 2 agility, and whenever he deals damage with an event or fight ability on event, he gets +1 damage once per phase. So he's the guy who wants to fight using events. So in order to promote that, he's got a whole bunch of events in his deck, such as 1-2 punch level 5. This is courtesy of the Man from Lang. There's a link to his channel in the description below, and you should definitely check him out if you haven't already. It's a great channel, a lot of cool content. So let's talk about 1-2 punch level 5. So event card, first thing that immediately jumps to attention, 4 combat icons on this thing. Okay, 2 cost, 5 XP, spirit and tactic traded, fight. You automatically succeed and deal +1 damage for this attack. You may fight again. You get +3 combat and deal +2 damage for that attack. Wow. So this is an upgrade to level 0 1-2 punch, which is also from that deck, which reads 2 cost event, single combat icon, spirit tactic traded, same. Fight, you get +1 combat for this attack. If you succeed, you may fight the enemy again. You get +2 combat and deal +1 damage for that attack. So 1-2 punch in most Guardians is you attack the same enemy 2 times, and if you hit both times, you deal 3 damage, right? Because the first attack only deals 1 damage, second attack deals 2 damage. And Nathaniel, this becomes 4 damage for for 2 attacks, which is actually pretty decent. Like, you can spread it out however you want. You probably want to do the extra damage on the first hit, because you might miss the second one, right? Autofill is a thing. But autofill isn't the thing for the level 5, because you automatically succeed on that first attack, and that is so crazy. It's worth pointing out that a skill test still happens, it's just you don't reveal any tokens and you are considered to be up against difficulty 0, right? You automatically succeed means don't reveal, or at least don't reveal a token, and you, automatically succeed and the difficulty is considered to be 0. So if you're a Guardian, which you're going to be if you have access to this, you can throw a Vicious Blow, or maybe you have Stunning Blow from Survivor. Or if you're off-class rogue, like Leo Anderson is, you can use this, and then you can throw in Double or Nothing, or you can throw in Watch This, or all kinds of other rogue cards, right? Like, this is a... Getting an attack that is just automatically successful is already, like, pretty powerful, even if it's only... And this is already, like, a 2 damage attack, right? Like, this is an automatic hit with normal weapons. Granted, it's 5 XP, but, you know, that's... Automatic damage in this game is quite potent. And the thing is, you don't lose an action for it, right? Because you basically hit for 2 damage, and then you get to attack again for 3 damage. If you're Nathaniel, this card is going to deal 6 damage. That's absurd. It seems really good, right? The nice thing about this also, which you might have noticed, the level 0 version has you attack the same enemy. If you succeed, you may fight that enemy again. Level 5 says no such thing. You get to hit whoever you want to hit. So if there's 2-3 health enemies, bam, first one down, second one down. Or maybe there's a 2 health enemy and a 4 health enemy. You've got the Pit Warden in Depths of Yoth, which is a 4 health monster. So you hit, you know, a smaller snake, and then you just lay the second one down. I think this card is excellent. I also think, worth pointing out, the second attack, like, that's still a +3 combat. If you're Nathaniel, and even if you don't have anything else going on, which seems unlikely, you're going to be you're attacking at 8. So this is probably just going to be incredibly good. Now, who takes this card? Well, Nathaniel, I think right now it's a little hard to tell what exactly he's going to upgrade into, because he doesn't seem like the kind who wants to bring big guns, because he wants to be doing his damage through events. So this seems amazing, but keep in mind, we still haven't seen a lot of his XP cards from his deck yet. So maybe this ends up not being an A tier purchase, but I think, I find it hard to imagine any situation in which just having 6 damage on tap isn't great. So I can see this in him. I can see this in almost every Guardian, if you just are like, well, it's near the end of the campaign, I've got 5 XP left from the scenario, we did quite well, let's just see if I can one-shot the boss with just like, you know, the old 1-2 punch. It just seems really strong. I think in Leo Anderson, who can take rogue cards to combo with this, that's even better. I can see someone like Mark picking this up, just because he's got like combat 5 at base. And also, it is a tactic worth remembering, so it works with Stick to the Plan. It also works with Boxing Gloves, which is the card that lets you find a spirit card, I believe. Yeah, so I've got them over here, because Boxing Gloves, which are one of the cards in Nathaniel Cho's deck, let you plus one combat while fighting, and if you defeat an enemy, you do get to search for a spirit event added to your hand. So, yeah, I mean, just an automatic success. I mean, this card just seems great. I just, like, even at its worst, right? Even if you can't afford to pay it, or maybe like it's not the right call, it's just, it's 4 combat icons. How bad is 4 combat icons? So yeah, I think this is going to be, it's not necessarily like a game changer for all Guardians, but I think it definitely adds a little bit of a panache to the Guardian faction that I think it gives it a little flair, right? Like with the recent rogues getting better and better at dealing with enemies, you know, Tony is an A-grade monster hunter, even though he's not actually a Guardian. I think it's important that Guardians get a little flashier, get a little bit cooler, because otherwise they're just going to be, you know, the worst class, or at least the most boring class. And this is exactly the kind of stuff they need. Just awesome automatic success again, and then just lay them all down. The other card is Randall Cho, the Concerned Brother, which is Nathaniel Cho's signature asset. A 2-cost asset, ally, and medic traded. He takes up the ally slot. Willpower, intellect, and wild icons. Nathaniel Cho deck only, as you would expect. And now there's a slot. There's a what I believe to be an error on this card, because it says fast action after he enters play. I'm going to assume this card is supposed to say reaction after he enters play, and I'm going to be evaluating the card from that perspective. If it turns out this is not a reaction, but it's supposed to be a fast action somehow, which I don't know how that would work rules-wise, then, you know, I'll make a video follow-up or whatever. But for now, assume it's a reaction. So reaction, after Randall Cho enters play, either heal 3 damage, or search your deck, or discard pile for your weapon asset, play it, paying its cost, and shuffle your deck. You gotta give this up, Daniel. Sooner or later, you're gonna get yourself killed. 1 health, 3 sanity. Wow. What a card. So first of all, good on FFG for including somebody in a wheelchair. We haven't seen a lot of characters in general with physical disabilities, so it's just nice to have that in there. But let's talk about the asset, the ability. This is great, right? This is exactly what you want in Nathaniel. Actually, it's kind of what you want, but also kind of not what you want, which is curious, because he finds a weapon asset, which Nathaniel doesn't really use weapons. Sure, he's probably going to use the boxing gloves, and those are actually weapon traded, so, you know, you can find the boxing gloves, and in fact, in your opening hand, you can play Randall for 2, and then play the boxing gloves for 3, and then you have your setup basically done. You can start punching people. But yeah, I don't know if Nathaniel really wants to have lots of weapons, so that's kind of curious. But on the other hand, the other side of this, which is healing 3 damage, also really strong, right? Like, Nathaniel got 9 health, 6 sanity, so the fact that this is essentially just gonna, you know, get him 3 health back and then presumably soak for a bunch of horror seems great, right? It's a cheap asset that gets you a nice benefit when you play it. I'm just really happy with it, right? This is exactly what I think you want for an effect like this. Immediately worth pointing out, Calling in Favors, which lets you return an ally to your hand and then search your deck for another ally, put them into play. So maybe you early on play Randall, you find your weapon of choice, whether that be the boxing gloves or something else, and then you get Randall back to hand with, or he soaks a couple of points of horror first, perfect. And then you call him in favors, pull him back, and then maybe play him again a second time to heal that damage for you. Just, yeah, powerful effect there. Seems really good. Worth pointing out, I mean, I've been talking about Nathaniel using events as his fighting style, and I presume that's going to be how he plays most of the time. There's actually nothing stopping you from just picking up a machete, right? Like, or a jumper blade, or even the 45 automatic, whatever you want, because sure, it gets plus 1 damage for events, but, you know, you can just build up a combination of some events and some assets to deal damage with if you just want to go, you know, Nobody's going to be upset, I think, if you put down that machete and start cutting up people. Like, that's just something guardians usually do. And so him being able to find any kind of weapon is actually really nice. Now, he might... The fact that he does take up that ally slot is a bit interesting. Because he wants to bounce in and out of play, preferably with calling in favors. But, you know, you don't need to. Other allies, I could see Nathaniel Cho taking, you know, guard dogs. When they take damage, you dish out damage, and it kind of lets you pile a little bit more damage because you are using these events, which maybe don't deal the most damage in quick bursts. So having extra ways of dealing damage quickly using something like Guard Dog is great. Also, you know, Beat Cop, similar idea. This one's the level 2 version. Gives you extra combat, so you hit even more likely to hit, and plus one extra or an extra damage whenever you need it. And I think actually, if we look at this as kind of a calling in favors thing, you can Rendle Cho to find either of these paying one or two because you only pay the difference. And it seems like a pretty solid deck. And you basically have this kind of very flexible amount of damage, right? Like normally when guardians have their big guns, right? Like their flamethrowers or lightning guns, they can only deal 4 damage or 3 damage. And with Nathaniel, I feel like you have a bit more control over how much damage you want to do, right? Like say there's a 3 health enemy. Okay, you just punch that one with a 1-2 punch taken care of. Or there's an enemy that maybe has 2 health. Okay, one hit with one of those events that doesn't give any bonus damage but gives you another effect. There's a clean them out that gives you 2 resources. Maybe there's a 4 health enemy and you only have a 3 damage or 2 damage plus 1 event, but then you can also use Beat Cop to ping them for 1. And I think in that way, he's going to have the right amount of damage for the job, which is something that I think trade people often say about the bar, which is a 4-speed weapon they'd like. Like, you always deal with the amount of damage you need to do in order to kill whatever you're fighting. And I think Nathaniel's going to be somewhat similar in that his ability to do the right amount of damage for every enemy is a trait that I think is very good for him. It lets him be flexible and versatile and not waste resources. Like, spending ammo on the flamethrower to deal with a 2-health enemy always feels awful. So yeah, that's Nathaniel. We don't know his weakness yet. We have some ideas. We know it's an enemy. We know it has something to do with damage dealing, but we haven't seen all of it yet. We have actually seen very few Nathaniel Cho cards. If you check out the number crunch spreadsheet that will be linked in the description below, you can actually see how many cards of each faction we have. Keep a track there. So yeah, that's the 2 new cards. Again, big thanks to the Man from Lang for previewing 1-2 Punch level 5 and Rendell Cho. Go check him out. And that's going to be it for those preview cards. Moving on, we have the Daisy Walker, Parallel Investigator. Okay, so if you haven't read the FFG article about Parallel Investigators yet, I would highly recommend you do that, because it does explain all of the rules and questions you might have. For now, though, I'm going to just try to cover it as quickly and concisely as possible as to not repeat their entire article. But basically, what we have is Parallel Daisy Walker, which is a different front and back for Daisy Walker. It's still an investigator called Daisy, but she has slightly different rules. Now, what's important is that you are not obligated to bring both sides of the parallel. You can bring old Daisy Walker, completely parallel Daisy Walker, parallel front but old back, or old front, new back. There's also 2 new signatures. I'll talk about those in a minute. So let's talk about what the actual new front is and new back. Daisy Walker is still the librarian. She has 1 willpower, 5 intellect, 2 combat, 2 agility. So the only difference is she lost 2 points of willpower, still Miskatonic traded, but you get plus 1 willpower and plus 1 sanity for each tome asset you control. Okay, so when she has 2 tome assets in play, she's the same as before, any more, and she's going to get more willpower. Fast action, 1 at a time, resolve an action ability on each tome asset you control, ignoring their action cost. Limit once per game. So this is a once per game kind of super moment. And then an elder sign effect, plus 1. You may return a tome asset from your discard pile to your hand. I can shut the books, but I can never unread its words. 5 health, 7 sanity, which you'll note is, again, 2 lower than the original Daisy. So basically, when you have 2 tomes in hand, the new Parallel Daisy Walker, or not in hand, sorry, in play, she's the same power level as before. any more than that, and she's going to go up. And I actually think that is her key. But before we go any further, let's actually read the back first. So, still deck size of 30, tome cards level 0 to 5, seeker cards 0 to 3, neutral cards 0 to 5, up to 5 other guardian and or mystic cards, all from level 0. The deck building requirements are the same. Okay, so that's a lot. So the tricky part here is that we're going to have to decipher which sides, you know, we want to combine. Do we want to go all new Daisy? Do we want to do half new Daisy, half old Daisy? Okay, first up, Daisy is worse than her old version if she has less than two tomes in play, but she gets better if you have more than that. Now, she does have her tote bag, so she can already have up to four hand slots that can each hold a tome. So potentially that would put her at a whopping 11 sanity and 5 willpower. And I think that's the key for this front side, because I think almost everybody agrees that that new ability, the once per game ability, is just not good enough when compared to a free action every single turn, which is this, you know, you get free actions to use all Book of Lore and stuff like that. But I actually think new Daisy doesn't want to run tomes like all Book of Lore. She wants to run tome like the fragments. So if we take a look at those, we can see here the Kalenio fragments, Book of Books. I don't know exactly how to pronounce that. It's a one cost tome asset that gives you a rolling boost depending on how many cards you have in hand. But the big part here is that it's a one cost tome asset that doesn't require any special actions. This card is probably not that great in Daisy, unless you're hoping to use her Elder Sign to draw lots of tomes, because Daisy wants tomes, old Daisy wants tomes that have action abilities, because you can get to use them for free. I think the important thing to think about Parallel Daisy is it's not the same investigator. She's not looking for the same things that the regular version is doing. She wants cheap, efficient tomes that she can use to boost her willpower and her sanity. Now, what do you do once you have that? Presumably spellcasting. And that's where I think we get into kind of the tricky part, which is that you need to find a way to have these kind of cards, these kind of tomes useful, while also using spells to do other things. And one of the tricky parts here is that the card that gives you more hand size, Dream Enhancing Serum, takes up an arcane slot, as well as the Arcane Enlightenment from the starter deck, that these are also from, they're both from Harvey's starter deck, also takes up the arcane slot. So we're kind of in this weird spot where if you want to have a ton of willpower with the new Daisy, you kind of can't use it because you end up having your spell slots filled with non-spell cards. So that's a bit of a twister, right? I'm not quite sure what to do with that. Now, if you're going that way, I think if you want to go, you know, spellcasting Daisy, have 5 willpower, maybe 6 willpower, 7 willpower, like how high can you go? Then you probably want to use the new front and the old back, because that gives you unlimited access to Mystic level 0 to 2. Because one of the tricky things is that the new backside gives you access to Guardian or Mystic cards, but only 5 of them and only level 0. So I think this new backside is quite confusing to me, because we don't have a lot of tomes that aren't already in Daisy's 0 to 5 Seeker, 0 to 2 Mystic. The only ones at time of recording are the Grimm's Fairy Tales from the starter deck, Stella Clark starter deck, which is a Survivor card, and Scroll of Secrets level 3, and the Book of Shadows level 3, which is a Mystic card that gives you an extra arcane slot and let you recharge spells. Now that card might be interesting, right? That might be a card you're interested in, but is it worth taking if it means you can't take any other Mystic cards that have Expay, right? It's that or, you know, Mystic level 0 to 2 cards like spells and such. So I am somewhat confused and I want to make her work, right? Like, let's get it out of the way real quick. I really, really, really want to make this new Daisy work, because I think the idea is super cool. And in general, I think Parallel Investigators are super cool. I'll get more to that in a second. But it's a real head scratcher, because it's basically powered down unless you have the ability to have a lot of tomes in play. Now, there are some ways to get a lot of tomes in play. Let's talk about our tote bag. So this is the tote bag you might remember from the core set, actually. So it's Daisy Walker's deck only. You get two extra hand slots, which give you tome assets. It's a bit boring, don't you think? I mean, we've seen this one, and we know what it does, and oh, we don't know what it does. Hello, and welcome to Advanced Signatures. So as you can see, this is still Daisy's tote bag, but now it has the Advanced keyword. What advanced keywords mean is that at any point during a campaign, you may choose to swap out a regular signature for the advanced signature. When you do, you also have to upgrade the corresponding weakness to its advanced weakness. So we'll talk about the advanced Necronomicon in a minute. You can only, once you've chosen to do this, you have committed to it. Once a card has been advanced, it cannot be turned back. So once you have this advanced tote bag in your pack, there's no going back. Now, what does the advanced tote bag do? Well, it gets an extra wild icon, just kind of nice. It still gives you two extra hand slots, but also when you play a tome asset during your turn, you can exhaust the tote bag to give that asset fast. So this means you basically don't waste actions putting tomes into play. Again, this seems to go well with the new Daisy, because if you want to put a lot of cheap tomes into play, you don't want to spend a lot of actions putting them all into play. Of course, this is also just great in old Daisy, like just old front, old back. You just get free assets, or well, your assets all gain fast, the important ones at least. Well, it's not entirely free, because you also have to upgrade the Necronomicon. So here we have the Necronomicon, John D. translation. Turns every Elder sign you reveal into an auto fail. Well, let's see what happens when we upgrade. The advanced makes it into the following. While it is in play, treat each Elder sign you reveal on a Chaos token as a Cultist, Tablet, and Elder Thing. Resolve all three. The Tree Horror and the Moving the Horror to Daisy stays the same. I love this. I love the idea of it. This is going to mess up somebody's day. Now, if you've ever played with the Necronomicon or in Daisy, you probably know that it's kind of annoying, but sometimes it just doesn't matter because how many Elder Signs are you going to reveal in the game anyway? I mean, sometimes there's 14, but then you're playing Crazy Town anyway. I've had some experience with friends of mine who've just pulled Elder Sign after Elder Sign, and I'm just sitting there with all my autofills crying. Normal Necronomicon just turns the Elder Sign into autofill. It's pretty straightforward. It's kind of bothersome, but it's not necessarily super detrimental unless you are really counting on that test to pass. This one is potentially ruinous. Although it doesn't cause the test to automatically fail, the combined effects of Cultist, Tablet, and Elder Thing could just destroy you. One thing I am curious about, and I'm assuming this is how it works, is it does replace the Elder Sign. I don't think you get to use the Elder Sign effect. Pretty sure that's because it doesn't say instead on here. I think it does say instead on here. No, it doesn't. So I guess it would work the same. Yeah. Okay. So yeah, you just don't get any Elder Sign effects just as before, and you get these Cultist Tablets and Elder Thing effects. And sometimes those effects aren't too bad, and sometimes they absolutely wreck you. Some funny things is there are of course a couple of scenarios that don't have those tokens. Sure, whatever. There's also in the Dream Eaters where some of those tokens are good, so that could be interesting. And the important thing is, if assuming none of those tokens are auto-fails, you know, sometimes a special token is just an automatic failure, it is possible that you still pass the test, because, you know, this is a seeker, they can go kind of high on their intellect. It is possible that you just pass the test, especially if the tokens aren't too bad. So keep that in mind. I actually think that the new Necronomicon isn't awful. It puts a little bit more pressure on you to actually clear the thing, because previously you could sometimes just ignore it. With this, it becomes a little riskier. But on the other hand, if you're halfway through a scenario when you see this, or maybe, you know, two thirds, the chances of you drawing, you know, more than one Elder Sign, pretty slim. So if you power through, you might just, you know, lose a hand slot, but that's it. And I think the new tote bag is definitely worth, you know, upgrading. So yeah, remember, you can do this at any time, whenever you want to. I believe it just has to be between scenarios, but don't quote me on that. It doesn't cost any XP either. I should mention that. It's zero XP. You just decide, no, I want the advanced signatures now. That's it for the cards we've been given. But of course, there's a little bit of room for speculation, because, well, these are the first parallel cards we've seen, and it opens up a doorway that I think some fans have already speculated for some years, which is that there are a couple of investigators in the game that have definitely landed on, let's say, the lower side of the power curve, right? There are a couple of investigators that could use a little bit of a boost. Now, Daisy is none of those, because Daisy is actually, like, one of the best investigators in the game. It's not the best. She's just outside that, like, S-plus tier or whatever, but she's definitely A tier. She's really good. But what I'm assuming is that they went, well, we want to test out this parallel investigator thing, and we want to do it in a way where we're not accidentally shooting ourselves in the foot by releasing something that's super broken or maybe, you know, doesn't land well. So they decided to give us a Daisy Walker that's not the most powerful, but a little tricky. And they know that even if, you know, maybe this one doesn't land perfectly, we still have normal Daisy. We still love normal Daisy. This isn't going to subtract from that Daisy. And the positive feedback they get from all these cards, which it's awesome, so yeah, means that they are probably going to be encouraged to do more of these. Now, what are some investigators that could maybe use it? Well, someone like Schizo Tool from the core set, he's the rogue. People have often maligned him as being, you know, just a little under the curve. Something that makes him a little stronger would be, you know, greatly appreciated by the many, many Skids fans. I'm personally, I love Skids. I really wish it was just a little bit better. But, you know, he's got 3 combat and he's got Guardian Access. Well, you could give him a different front that maybe has higher combat, so he can use that higher combat with his Guardian Access. Or you give him a different back that also removes the Guardian Access for something more useful, like, say, Survivor Access. I know there's someone in the Mythosbuster Discord that has tried Schizo Tool with Survivor Access, and that actually works really well. So there's a lot of stuff they could do, and I think that would be exciting. Other investigators, Father Mateo, his once per game ability is fun, but maybe not the most powerful, and his stat line leaves a lot to be desired. Likewise, Jim. Jim actually, in my mind, was a perfectly serviceable investigator. He's a bit below the curve, but, you know, whatever. But then recently, you know, with the release of Jacqueline, or at least the announcement of Jacqueline, he's starting to suffer a lot, because all the things he likes to do, which is reveal lots of tokens and show kind of cool combos, that's something Jacqueline can also do, but just better. So hoping for a gym or a parallel investigator. Finally, there is, of course, always Lola Hayes, the neutral investigator from Carcosa. And, I mean, she's a whole episode worth of questions and answers and everything, but I would love to see a new Lola, because I think Lola is a cool ID that just kind of suffered under the restrictions they put on her. And I understand that they want to be careful with an investigator that could do all kinds of crazy combos, but, you know, now that they've seen several years have passed, Lola still isn't, like, really all that good. Maybe give her another shot at a more powerful version. I know there's a lot of Lola fans, so, you know, I think they deserve it, right? They've been sticking through with Lola. I think, you know, let's give Lola a parallel investigator that's actually, like, really powerful, change her up a bit. Would be really cool. Okay, so I think that's everything for the news. I haven't been releasing any kind of playthrough videos recently. Recent events have just kind of conspired against me there. I'm planning on doing something pretty soon. I haven't quite settled on what that is yet, or, you know, you'll see it when you get it. Also, just wanted to mention, I updated the thumbnails, and if you have any feedback on that, I would love to know it. I decided to stop with the color gradient, because I found it just kind of looked ugly sometimes, and this gives a bit of more consistent feel and look to the channel. So I hope you like it. If you don't, or if you do, you know, let me know. Love to hear from it. I think this is awesome. I think Arkham is, despite all the circumstances in real life, is doing very well, and I hope you can all stay safe out there. Hope you're doing well, and hope we can all get, you know, play lots of Arkham when the quarantine stops and it's all over. So thank you for watching. Have a great day, and I'll be seeing you until the end of time.